I've got a riddle for you. Right here, very soon, two brand new homes will be built, which will also be the oldest houses in New Zealand. So, how does that work? Marty Verry is a man in his element. His love of the outdoors and natural materials has earned him a reputation as the timber guy. Marty found an outlet for his passion when he and his father bought the Southern Hemisphere's largest woodmill in Rotorua.
Do you know when we'll see that conveyor working?
It'll be commissioned at Christmas.
Okay.
But despite unlimited access to local timber, he's about to build a house that defies logic.
So we're going to build something which nobody in New Zealand's ever done before because of the materials we're going to be bringing in from overseas. Colleagues in the industry are saying, why aren't you using timber? And hopefully they'll be pleasantly surprised with the amount of timber we are using, how we're going to go about it. But it's going to be unique, and it's going to be big, and it's going to be beautiful, I think.
200 kilometres away, on the fringes of Auckland City, lies the fashionable suburb of Gray Lynn. When he's not at the mill, Marty lives here with his Venezuelan doctor wife, Mirella, and their daughters, Alessandra and Sophia. Marty and Mirella first moved here 14 years ago, after a whirlwind European courtship.
I was playing rugby in Paris, she was there. She thought I was Irish, I thought she was French. We got talking. And turned out we were both wrong, but we liked each other, and so I had a few days catching up over in Europe, and then I came back to New Zealand. 5 months later, Mirella came here.
I moved into another country to live with them after 5 days, literally, in Europe. So it was that first year was a bit, who's this guy? But then we got married, and that was like, okay, well, that's on now. How do we make it work?
Well, it was 14 years ago, so it seems to have endured. We've doubled the average life expectancy of a marriage, I think.
But after years in the city, Marty has started hankering after a change of lifestyle.
Well, I was brought up in the country. My first memory was moving from the city to the country, packing up the car with a cat on my lap and driving the old Kingswood station wagon out to the farm. And that was a profound impact on me as a kid. And loved it, and I wanted the kids to experience that as well.
And I was that. Now I grew up in a city with 5 million people. I've only lived in big cities. For me, Auckland was quite an adaptation in itself. So going to the country was a no for many years, and until I think I saw that the kids were getting hooked on the iPad and being able to offer something else and to make it clear that there was an outdoor is, I think, what made me change my mind, really.
Well, the first time I went there, these guys were tippy-toeing around all the sheep poo, going, ooh, yuck, ooh, and I thought, well, that's not a Kiwi kid. We're gonna have to make sure they get to the country to break them out of that.
So Marty and Mirella are packing up their house.
Okay, books.
And Mirella's reservations, and preparing to leave their suburban neighbourhood of quaint villas to pursue Marty's dream. A place where the girls will cast aside their electronic devices and have more room to grow. A mere 25 minutes from Auckland City, they have found 10 acres with all the ingredients for Marty's quintessential rural Kiwi life.
Okay, Chris, how you going?
Hi, Marty.
Good to meet you.
Hi, nice to meet you.
Okay, can we go to the kids' zone now?
Yeah, go.
Bye.
See ya. Looks as though the girls are really settling in.
Yeah, they make out they don't like it out here on the farm, but you bring them out here and they run amok.
So here we are on site. Tell me about what kind of house you're going to build.
We have purchased from a company in Texas 230-year-old barns that originally came from New York State, the Mohawk Valley.
Where on earth did that idea come from? You're a timber guy. producing timber for the local market, why on earth did you go to the States?
I've wanted to build, and if you like, you know, these rustic-y type places. Then you ask yourself, where do you get those timbers? And so I searched for the timbers and then came across the barns. And I thought, okay, I get the timbers and I can also get the heritage, the story, the 230-year-old story behind this pioneering barn.
This is what Marty fell in love with. Not much to look at, but Marty could see potential. So 12,000 kilometres away, the two old barns are being stripped of their cladding and dismantled. After being shipped across the Pacific, they'll arrive with a team of specialist American builders. Using traditional 18th century building methods, the American team will raise the original barn frames. The smaller barn will be transformed into a rustic guest house. Then it's the larger barn that will form the heart of Marty and Morella's home. The historic timbers will be clad with pine from Marty's mill and connected to a bedroom wing and garage. The combined buildings will be four times the size of the average New Zealand house. Inside the main barn, 130 square metres of floor space and three-storey high ceilings lend a cathedral-like air to the open living area and provide plenty of opportunity to showcase weathered timbers from the old barns. On the mezzanine floor, Morella's office and a library look over to a giant schist chimney rising 7.5 metres to the ceiling. The house will be a marriage of different times and styles, part historic barn, part modern farmhouse. And the project manager for this pioneering build is Marty.
Marty, have you ever done a build like this before?
No.
No?
No, no. No.
It's a huge risk. You've got basically two completely different construction teams working on this, completely different technologies, coming from quite different eras.
Marty loves risk.
Oh, it's a challenge, but it's a good challenge. It's fun. I think we're going to have a lot of fun doing it.
So the big question, what's it going to cost?
We think it will be somewhere north of $1.5 million to build, but south of $2 million.
You got that pretty well nailed down?
No.
So, Morella, what do you see the biggest challenge being?
The marriage.
The marriage? What, you mean the marriage between the structure and the cladding?
No. I mean our marriage.
Oh, boy.
My mother is an architect. My father was an engineer, and they built our house together. Oh, my God, what a nightmare. That took 3 years and lots of screaming. And actually, the couple of conversations we've had about the house is like we, you know, I think it would take ages just to agree on anything. So, do I really get involved in the house and then have an argument every 2 days, or do I just pull back and let him do his thing because he's the one who really wants to build and he's the one that came up with the crazy barn idea as well.
So, Morella has had quite a few wins in the process, but generally speaking, no, we're not doing the democracy thing.
Marty has got unlimited access to wood with his own timber mill, yet he's about to invest $140,000 in some old barn structures from America that he's only ever seen in photos. He hasn't got building consent for the big barn. It's never been done in New Zealand before, and not even his family are on board. What is he thinking? 2 years after Marty and Morella bought their land, the giant shipping container carrying the 15-ton barn timbers has arrived at ports of Auckland after a month on the high seas.
We've never seen the actual frames themselves before, so, you know, they're over 200 years old, so we're very much looking forward to seeing, you know, what they look like, and, you know, that'll give us an idea of what the house is going to look like eventually. We're hoping that they're all in one piece and they're all there. Oh, I'm excited. Yeah, it's great. Finally.
Marty's also paid to fly in two specialist heritage builders from Texas to erect the old barns.
Do you recognise this one?
I do.
Okay.
I recognise it well.
We're going to open it up and it's all going to be gone.
It better not be gone. Magic. After all this.
It's a magic trick.
There we go. Wow.
It might just look like a pile of old wood, but this is the start of Marty's dream.
That looks really, really nice. Look at that. The colour's beautiful. The renovations come up really, really well. You can see the work you've done in Texas here. All the preparation work, because have you pieced these together previously?
We've taken them apart in New York State, then we've shipped them to our yard in Texas. Then we'll pre-fit everything and make sure that everything goes together square and plumb, so it's ready for your project.
So we're expecting a couple of smooth days coming up when you put it up.
That's the plan.
Good.
Yeah, that's the plan.
Very happy. Let's get them out.
Well, we're just trying to maneuver this this beam out. It's the first one, so it's the tightest one.
Another foot.
Another foot?
I need another foot. Yep. These were some of the earliest buildings in America, and you can see when you look down it, along here, you can see the hand-hewn, hand-cut nature of the whole thing. It just gives the house, it gives the barn instant history.
These are the first American barns to come to New Zealand, and Marty's going to have some challenges incorporating them into modern building practices.
Well, the thing about New Zealand building construction drawings is that they're accurate down to the millimetre. And I guess what we're going to be trying to do is marry up 230-year-old beams that are cut from trees which had natural bends in them anyway and applied in barns in America to New Zealand's building code. So if you look at this piece, for example, now you can see a huge undulation there, and yeah, that's going to cause some challenges for our builder. He's going to have to work this one out.
The biggest beam is a 9.5-metre long swing beam, which was once attached to oxen to grind grain.
This is why I went for this barn, for this beam. Just the whole size of it, the solidity of it, the scale of it. Done.
Woo! But Marty can't take his timbers home yet. New Zealand's stringent border controls require the wood to be heat treated overnight to get rid of any pests or contaminants that may have hitched a ride across the Pacific. The timbers have never been in a kiln, and biosecurity have never heat treated a historic barn before either. There's a chance the aged beams could dry out and crack or distort.
The problem is you're trying to dry out in the same kiln very large pieces of timber with small pieces of timber. And if the smaller ones over dry, then that can be a problem. But that's why they've got to keep the moisture going in there. Just keep it to the right temperature. It's just so that the timbers stay stable, because they're over 200 years old, so they're already quite bent.
It's a little bit concerned. It's something we've never done before, and it has got quite a bit of heritage, and there's a lot of effort gone into this. So we'd hate it to come to grief at our stage of the process.
The kiln temperature and humidity are carefully monitored, but everyone's still holding their breath that the barns don't get overcooked. After standing strong for more than 200 years, it would be a cruel twist if the old beams were damaged so close to the end of their journey. After 200 years in New York State, a road trip to Texas, an 11,000-kilometre sea voyage, and 14 hours in a biosecurity kiln, Marty's American barns are arriving at their new home. And it appears that they're none the worse for their ordeals. Morella, the girls, and some friends have come to see the old bones of their new house for the first time.
No wonder Daddy said that it was heavy.
It's gonna take forever to piece it.
I know, I imagine it's like a big Lego. I remember when Marty first showed me the website saying, oh, this is what I want for the house. I was like, you're crazy. This is, why would you want to import a barn from America when you're in New Zealand? But hey, he's got his ideas and he goes for them. And so I said, yeah, sure, you do what you want. And it's actually quite cool. It's a bit historical, you know, it's like having a museum piece incorporated into your house. It feels quite warm inside, actually.
The heritage builder's first challenge is working out how to put the beams together again. Fortunately, someone labeled them 200 years ago.
If you look on the beam here, you can see these Roman numerals. Here you've got a 9. There's going to be another piece that fits into here, and it's going to have corresponding number 9, just like that. And only that piece can go into this place. It's called a marriage mark. Those Roman numerals would have been from the original craftsman.
A concrete foundation has been laid for the smaller guest barn, but that's where modern building practice ends for this phase of the build. The carpenters are assembling the barn frames using almost the same techniques employed two centuries ago.
Now what we're doing is we're situating each piece where it goes, out here on the ground, and then we're gonna lift it all up in one bay at a time. So they're just putting the finishing touches, nailing in those oak wooden pegs. The peg's called a trunnel, which is actually from the Old English, meaning tree, nail, trunnel. I'll lift this. If you want to just turn that on the long end, we just need a little bit of height. Ready?
Ready.
Okay. Yep. Once you've got it there, go ahead. Try to hit it as square as possible with the head of the hammer. There you go. Marty is definitely the hardest working homeowner we've had yet.
Marty's dead proud. He's about to become the first New Zealander to raise an historic American barn. But seeing the build kick off is making Marilla nervous about the prospect of their rural life.
Marty grew up on a farm, so he always had a little fun in the farm, I guess, and he saw the advantage of it. I grew up in a city, so I had no reference point, really. The truth is, I got terribly scared of the countryside. Nothing like a city for me.
Marty, one will go on that post, one will go on the far one.
Marty seems oblivious to Morella's worries. He's having the time of his life.
I'm not going to miss out on this. This is what every kid wants to do. Putting together jigsaws, knocking pegs into these holes. You know, it's been 40 years since I did that.
Despite the comparison, things are not as straightforward or straight as building with toy blocks. It seems the heat in the kiln may have damaged some of the timbers after all.
So we're just chiseling this off because potentially the wood has moved in the kiln. There's a new crack there and it's a little bit too tight for the hole now. We're working with wood. The thing about working with wood is you can make changes on the fly very, very easily.
Yeah, it's a little bit of a surprise to me that it would have shifted, but it does seem like it did.
As Team Texas gets to grips with the wood's new quirks, Marty and Morella's Kiwi builder, Mike Jelena, arrives to get his first look at the timbers for the big barn. This is the wood he'll be working with as he builds the main house over the next 18 months.
They're more rustic than what I thought they would be. Yeah, definitely.
These are the rafters. And you can see there's a bit of a twist and there's a bit of a bend in the rafters from the original shape of the tree.
With those beams coming up against the lining inside, there's going to be quite a bit of variance, you know.
Bit of flexibility required.
Yeah, yeah. Hopefully it all works.
It's worth going the extra effort to do something different and unique. It's harder. It's taken ages to get into play. Just all the planning and working my way through the engineering and building consent process and working out can we build in New Zealand with these species of timber and how to get them in and how to get it structurally right. But now it's happening and it's going to be worth it.
Marty, Morella and the girls will live in the smaller guest house barn while the big house is built. Given some of the timber has already been damaged, I wonder how the beams for the large barn will survive being left outside until it's their turn to rise. While work continues on site, the bedroom wing is already being put together 160 kilometres away. Marty's mill provides wood to another company he owns. This one specialises in much more modern building methods. So what's happening over here?
So three components. We've got frames for Marty's, which will run through this line. We've got trusses for Marty's, which will be produced on this element. And then we've got floor cassettes that will run through this way.
Managing Director Jason Cordes reckons using this technology will save Marty vast amounts of build time.
So start to finish, we would expect Marty's job for floors, wall and trusses to take us inside 2 weeks, typically closer to 1 week to produce everything.
Impressive. I mean, this is the future of building. In a way, New Zealand has kind of been sitting in the dark ages for a long time. I mean, traditional trades, out in the wet, on site, exposed to the weather. I mean, the secret is to be in a factory producing these things, isn't it?
Absolutely.
Marty's crazy about wood, and the old barns are not the only historic timbers he's incorporating into his house.
Let's check out these old power poles.
He's been trawling recycled timber yards for treasures.
What I'm after is I want to make a mantelpiece out of one of these, right?
Yep.
And I need it to be 110 millimetres deep.
Yep.
And as wide as you can make it, but with a bit of wane on the front side. This one's got a bit of sweep on it, but that's the sort of thing I think we're going to need. Hey, I saw a couple of things over here I was going to have a chat to you about as well.
Yep.
That's a piece of New Zealand's history. So that was off Hobsonville Wharf at the Navy or Air Force Base?
Air Force Base
at Hobsonville Wharf. What I'm thinking is, you know, I've got this big open paddock and I'm trying to get some decoration in it.
Yep.
But
yep.
If I could set that in concrete or two or three of these in concrete and create a little cluster of them, they're not everyone's cup of tea, but they would fit they'd fit my project.
Yeah, definitely.
So is this all your rubbish down here, is it?
Nothing's rubbish, but yeah.
Nothing's rubbish.
Old, new, native, exotic, power poles, wharf posts. Marty's throwing everything into the mix.
Those are bandsaws.
Can I grab one of those?
Sure.
Because I think I might be able to use it to make my antler chandelier.
Or should I say anything?
Did you say an antler chandelier?
Yeah.
I'm a big fan of prefabrication, and I love the idea of a hybrid house where new technology combines together with old, recycled timber barn structures. I just hope Marty approaches this build with creativity and care. If it's done right, the elements could be combined in a brilliant juxtaposition. If not, it could be a clumsy mess. It's now been 8 months since the Texan team returned to America. Engineering delays have meant Marty and Morella still haven't got council consent to turn the big barn into their main house. And the barn timbers have spent a wet winter under tarps.
Been on site a little while now, and it's got a bit wet, unfortunately, but we're going to let it dry out now. This is one of the big cross beams. Down here we've got the oak rafters. You know, I'm not too worried, this will dry out. It's here and it's ready for the Auckland Council to give us our building consent.
Marty's had to rejig his build schedule, but he is able to get started on the more straightforward bedroom wing of his country mansion.
So we can stand H up and then we can put I on.
These are the panels we saw in the frame and pre-cut factory. These arrived a couple of days ago and they were all in place within about 3 hours. And what it meant is we got an instant platform to work from today. So it's probably saved about 2 weeks on site.
As the prefabricated walls come together to reveal the form of the bedroom wing, I'm thinking that this process resembles a modern day echo of a barn raising.
It's great, look at the window. You can start to see the framing of every view from every room now. It was just a paddock, and now suddenly there's a house coming to life here. And you can really start to see it once the frames go up.
But the project manager's plans to raise the bedroom wing in one day are looking increasingly unlikely.
Bloody hell, now it's starting to hail.
Put the jug on, Marty.
Hey, cup of tea.
With Marty driving the build, I'm wondering how Morella's faring in the passenger seat.
Hi, Morella.
Hey, how are you?
Good to see you.
Good.
Her willingness to let Marty take the lead seems at odds with the independent woman who moved across the world on a whim.
When we first met, you talked about how you're going to step back. How are you coping with that? That can't be easy for somebody like you. I guess I'm a little bit confused because, I mean, you're a highly educated doctor and you're really somebody who doesn't lack the volition to go and make decisions. Surely you'd want to get involved.
It's probably one of the hardest things I've ever done, you know? And I've been telling myself, this is a learning of self-discipline. Because it was voluntary. I actually voluntarily withdrew and I said, you deal with it.
Do you think that you've given Marty a gift so that he can actually design his dream home? Or have you so much trust in him that he's actually going to do it for both of you?
A lot of what he chooses is along my taste anyway, which is partially why I pulled out as well. I knew that he couldn't do anything too wrong. For me, the whole prospect of building is daunting. You know, I think it feels like one of those very scary rides that you're invited to, and you're like, oh, it's really not my thing, you know? And then you actually go in, Okay, let's do it then. And then you're on the roller coaster going, wow, best thing ever. And I'm still on the upside down.
Fourteen months after the American Barnes arrived in New Zealand, Marty and Mirella finally get consent to build their house. Today, foundations are being laid in preparation. The bedroom wing is complete, ready for the arrival of the centerpiece of Marty and Mirella's new home. But that's not all. The little barn has been transformed into a guest house. They've now sold their Grey Lynn house, so they'll move in here while the new home is being built.
Oh, I like the mismatched sizes of the vertical boards. They look great.
Yeah, random width. Yeah. Keeps it interesting and sort of mixes it up a bit, eh? Yeah. Bit of texture.
Yeah.
Come on in, Chris.
My goodness, look at this. This is huge.
Yeah, it's a big void. 7.5 metres high.
The small barn has been transformed into an open-plan guest house. The old barn timbers contrast beautifully with the stark white walls, creating a light and airy feel.
Up on the ceiling, what's the sarking?
We got redwood sarking, some from New Zealand and some from America.
To help the old timbers sit flush with the walls and rafters, the builders had to trim some of the hidden edges.
Yeah, the builders had a lot of trouble getting that marrying up. Those oak rafters were very bent. And on the main barn, we've got a whole bunch more of those to try to work out.
In my view, this has offered you a fantastic opportunity to really nut out those issues. Mm-hmm. In a way, it's a trial, isn't it, for the big barn that's coming. And the complexity of that one, a lot more timbers to go together.
That's right, and that's why we're using a lot more windows in that one as well, which means that's why we're having such trouble with the engineer, trying to get the engineering finalised for it.
Marty has successfully converted this barn to a warm living space, but the main barn is bigger, has more frames, is being extended, and is 3 stories high.
It seems to me that you're just extremely at home in that scale.
Yeah.
Which isn't really domestic.
I feel a bit hemmed in with a 2.4 metre stud or a 2.7 metre stud. Yeah, I feel pretty hemmed in by those, so I like space around you,
The thing that's interesting about this one is that even though the volume is huge, in plan, it still feels quite intimate. Mm. And I'm wondering if the challenges in the other one might be quite different, because the barn, in a way, sets the tone for everything, doesn't it?
Yes.
So, yeah. And it's big.
Yeah, yeah.
Everything is supersized, isn't it?
Yeah. We didn't go out to say, let's build a big, gutsy, bloody building. It's just that if you start with a big barn frame from America, then everything flows from that.
As winter kicks in, the Heritage team returns to raise the biggest old barn in the country.
You must be really excited. I mean, is this the bit of the build that, the really meaty part, the heart of the house?
This is what we've been looking forward to. This is what we have built the whole concept around the back of. And, after 2 years of planning, the day's finally come.
I'm relieved to see that the old timbers appear to have survived a year under tarps unscathed, apart from a bit of lichen.
Yeah, it looks good for the most part. It has a little New Zealand organic matter on it, but clean it up a little bit and it'll be as good as new 200 years later.
There's a real buzz of excitement as everyone assembles what Marty reckons will be the oldest house in New Zealand.
For us as New Zealanders, timber as a building material is really in our bones. But the techniques being used today on the erection of this structure
predate European settlement of New Zealand.
And for me, that's what really brings this project alive, because the texture and the stories that are told in these structures are what makes it absolutely special.
By day's end, the main barn frame is erected, towering above the adjoining bedroom wing and the distant guest house. It's only now that the sheer scale of this house becomes apparent for the first time.
This is architecture at its most elemental. It's like a giant whale skeleton. The question for me is, can it make the transition from agricultural barn to a warm, cosy family home?
With the big barn skeleton up, Marty and Mirella have moved into the newly completed guest barn. I'm curious to find out how Mirella and the girls are coping with country life.
So, how's it going living here?
Well, actually, it's not bad at all. It's like the mood has changed in the family. And the kids have actually completely changed behavior. It used to be nang, 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 nang. And now they come home and it's like, let's go and get the eggs. I had no idea I was going to enjoy so much having animals. No idea. I thought chickens, whatever. Turns out that they're extremely funny.
Yeah.
And then finally we got a puppy. That's the other thing. It's like having their favorite child because he doesn't complain about anything. He's just fabulous.
Tell me what you don't like.
Actually, you know what I do miss is a wardrobe, because everything is in a box.
So would you be happy to stay here and just not bother with the big house?
At one point I said to Marty, why exactly are we building another one? You know, if I had a wardrobe, I could live here forever.
But Mirella shouldn't get too snug. A mansion awaits her. In an era when small houses are becoming increasingly popular, Marty and Mirella's house is huge. The bedroom wing alone is larger than the average New Zealand family home. Add in the garage and the barns, and the whole house sprawls over 650 square metres. This is a hefty build, but I'm amazed to discover that the barn frame has had to be encased in steel. Although the old beams have stood soundly for more than two centuries, they've been deemed unfit to be the main structural support for the house.
Well, this looks pretty serious, Marty. Couldn't that have been replaced by engineered timber, or I'm just thinking, being a timber man?
Yeah, not so happy about having to use it. Bit of a necessary evil. I actually didn't realise he was going to use that much. The engineer's just over-engineering everything in New Zealand nowadays, in my view. So, you know, it's just an example of that. But we'll clad all this and we'll ignore it and try to forget that it's there and that we've destroyed the environment by using so much steel. We've got heaps of timber to make up for it.
That's effectively the structure. And then we've got this interior decoration, isn't it?
Yeah.
This beautiful, exotic,
primarily
sculpture,
yeah.
Isn't it?
It's a sort of a $60,000-$70,000 piece of decoration. But it looks great. It's given us the character and history that we're after. And it's given it that rustic feel, the textured feel and warmth that only timber can give.
The old barn can, however, hold up the mezzanine floor.
And you're getting a good impression here now with the corrugated iron there of almost how the mezzanine will feel. This is going to feel really low here, actually, compared to the vastness of the overall roof.
Yeah, but it is good to have a mezzanine, otherwise the whole thing would feel like a huge hall. So breaking it up with the mezzanine, I think, is going to add a bit of character and just fill the space a bit more.
Yeah. And what are we seeing here?
This is my internal garden.
Internal garden?
Yeah. We had a conservatory in one of my old houses where I used to live when I was a kid, and I liked the, you know, bringing the green. But we've got such a big space as well, so it's just, I think it's good to bring a bit of greenery into it and help fill it up and bring a bit of nature inside. So I'm not sure what's going to go in there yet. We haven't designed that yet, but It'll be something, you know, something typically that you'd see in an office garden.
An office garden?
Yeah, something you'd see in offices.
Interesting.
A mezzanine and internal garden. I'm wondering if it's enough to prevent this huge space from feeling cavernous. By early spring, the building site is a hive of activity. The house is being clad, landscaping is underway, and the stonemasons have started creating a towering three-storey high schist chimney.
You guys are making good progress, eh? You might be going more than a metre or so a day, the way you're going.
It'll slow up when you get higher.
It slows up when you get higher, yeah.
it's looking good.
The barns and this house have always been Marty's vision, but now that the end is in sight, someone else wants to make their mark.
So, let's see.
So where are we at with the kitchen?
I got the sample today, so that's the blackest granite that they can get. As you can see, it's a bit speckled, but so
that's going to be honed as well, eh?
Yeah.
Okay, that'll look good.
I do have a sense of colours and what would look nice spatially and so on. So this is sort of like my side of things, I've realised, and so I'm really happy to do that side actually. Yeah. And Marty seemed to be okay about it. He hasn't even bothered. I just come with samples and
Yeah. Yeah, I prefer to deal with the builders and the tradesmen, and you can
go to the curtain shops. So the other thing was, remember how I wanted to put a bit of color in this kitchen? So I wanted to have red tiles all around here, and I'm realizing that I've got bugger all space here for somebody who doesn't professionally do this. I think he's done a very good job. One of my big concerns at the beginning was, well, how is this going to turn out? Because he really took over the whole project and was choosing everything and project managing and architecting, and you know, it was like, oh my God, what are we gonna end up with? But no, I think most of it works. Most of it works.
It all works.
No, not everything. For example, there's the guest bathroom. You open the door and then the bathroom door also opens in that direction. When actually it's a huge bathroom, we could have hit the shower somewhere else, and then that's the shower. And then of course he says, oh, I didn't think about that one too much. And I'm like, well, you have to think about everything. You know, it's not just because it's a guest bathroom that you don't dedicate some time to it. The roof is gray. I don't like gray. Gray is the one color I don't do. And I drive through the gate one day and I see that the roof is gray. I felt like, okay, does he actually know me?
No, that's all I had in stock. So we had to keep on.
Yeah, and I hear you.
We had to get it done.
But still, yeah. Sort of.
But you need to understand the parameters of the decision that's being made.
The funny part is that you can get used to anything. So I'm used to the gray roof now.
Exactly.
It's unbelievable. Baby, if that thing is in the middle, I can give you a hug. Come here. Come here.
No, we can't move though. It's just a scaffolding coming between us.
No, I think he's done very well. Seriously, he's really done well.
It's getting there.
Yeah.
It's getting there. Still a couple of months to go. So don't count your chickens yet.
It's always been hard to believe that with such strong opinions, Mirella has stood on the sidelines for so long. But I can't wait to see what she brings to their home now she's finally getting involved. Over the last 18 months, I've been impressed with Marty's single-minded pursuit of his vision for a home built around an old American barn. But I've had some doubts about the concept. The last time I was here, the living space felt so huge. I was quite concerned as to whether or not they could make it feel homely and really a livable space. So I'm intrigued to see, have they actually managed to pull that off? Two barns stand like sentinels at either end of what is now a sprawling estate. From the outside, the family home built around the bigger barn feels a bit like a ski lodge or hotel. The scale is truly huge, but I've never seen it furnished or heard how Marty and Mirella plan to fill the space and make it their own.
Hey. Hi, guys.
Hey.
I can't wait to
see you.
Welcome back.
Gosh, it's huge. You have been busy.
Flat out for the last few months, that's for sure. Yeah.
The chimney looks awesome. I mean, the scale of it is just vast.
You wait until
come and check it out from in here.
The inside.
Oh, let's have a look. Oh my goodness, it's even bigger than I remember.
Really?
Yeah, yeah.
I think it's got a human scale to it. It's like walking into a forest.
Yeah, but forests are big. Yeah. They don't have human scale, they're huge. The scale in here allows each of these different areas that you've got to float, almost like islands. The whole area around the fireplace has its own domain, completely different to where the dining is. And the same with your tropical forest in the middle there.
Some of these are going to grow up to 5 or 6 metres high. That's going to be quite a good size 2 metre by 2 metre garden in there.
And also the chest is a bit like the rock wall. So I really feel like I'm living in nature.
The average New Zealand ceiling height is 2.4 metres. Marty and Mirella's is 8.3. It feels grand, cathedral-like and liberating at the same time.
All of this is really big and generous and expansive. And then I turn around at this. And this feels intimate. I mean, the kitchen is very domestic in scale.
And cozy and warm, isn't it?
Yeah, it is. It's gutsy, and I love the dark timbers that you've chosen.
This house was always going to be a homage to Marty's favourite building material. Not just in the use of American barn structures, but in the eclectic mix of wood, old beams from his sawmill, recycled telephone poles, and native timbers.
Gosh, lots of different timbers I see. Oak on the floor, is it?
Yep, American oak, beaten up by chains and nuts and bolts. cedar on the cupboards, and we've got the recycled Remu continuing right the way through both blocks to sort of create that continuity.
So where are we here?
We call it the kids' nook. It's for the kids to watch TV and play with their friends, and sort of it's right outside their bedrooms.
What I'm also seeing in the mix is Mirella's Venezuelan sensibility. While the family's still not fully moved in, it's her colourful touches that are bringing this house to life.
It's playful.
When you say it's playful, they can do whatever they like and you'll never know. You'll be playing down the other end.
Oh, they come into the teenage years, mate. We'll be keeping an eye on this end of the house.
Both Alessandra and Sophia have spacious bedrooms with doors opening out onto the estuary and share a beautifully appointed bathroom, where to avoid sibling squabbles, they have their own sinks.
This is a master bedroom?
Oh my goodness. I love the raked timber ceiling. Beautiful, and all your amazing colours and textures. Where did all these come from?
Oh, this is years of compiling.
So all different travels, different stories.
Yeah. Yep.
Behind a curtain is the wardrobe Mirella's been waiting for, and a generous ensuite. Big spaces can make you feel a bit anonymous, but this home is full of personal connections. Every piece of timber Marty has brought to the house has a fabulous story and compliments Mirella's eye for the quirky and poetic.
This place is vast. It really is a grand design in the sense of, you know, quantity, not just quality.
You've got to think big. I like to think big. You have to think anyway, so you might as well think big.
How did it come in terms of budget?
I think I said 1.5 mil when we first started the process, so that was just a real guess. I think the approach we've taken is just we're going to design what we want, build what we want, and then find a way to pay for it. And so, yeah, it's coming in, it's going to be about 1.8, 1.9 by the time it's finished for this place, which is a little bit over, but we've had the benefit of selling that place in Grey Lynn, and that kind of, in the period of this project, it went up by about 300 or 400K, which pretty much paid for the excess over the original number I gave you in terms of the budget.
I kind of feel that this isn't Marty's house. I mean, at the beginning when we started on this journey, yes. Mirella, what were the real reasons that you were not involved at the beginning?
We're very strong characters, both of us. And so I think in a project there has to be a chief, really. And so the only way to still be married in the end, I saw was me stepping out of it.
Because buildings, it's not an objective thing. There's no perfect building, no right or wrong. And, you know, I won't say that there hasn't been a lot of stress throughout the period, but, you know, we got there, we got the house done. The house is nearly done, the relationship...
We're still married, baby.
Yeah. The relationship probably needs a bit of renovation, but it's probably nothing a few naughty weekends away where the kids won't fix. It has been a shared dream, though. It's become a shared dream. I think the kids have really bought into the whole rural living.
It seems an appropriate metamorphosis for a family who have moved from the city to live in a home designed around a 200-year-old barn.
Something I really like about this building is that those very simple people who caught these logs by hand would have never dreamed that their work would be transported to the other side of the world 200 years later and be incorporated into a grand building. And for me, that is a way of giving them, in a way, their legacy.
Funny thing is, the structure came from North America and the finishing came from South America.
But it's got a Kiwi mark to it, too.
Oh, it's definitely a Kiwi home.
This build has been all about marriages, a marriage of cultures, of eras, of building materials, and not least, of Marty and Mirella's marriage. I had concerns that all these elements might fight each other, but instead, they've complemented each other and transformed these vast agricultural buildings into a warm, vibrant, and welcoming family home.
Oh, look at that.
Oh, there you go, mate. Just something I whipped up for you. End of a hard day.
You have done well.
Cheers.
Cheers. Congratulations.
Thank you.
supporting local content so you can see more of New Zealand on Air.